Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. So in today's episode, we have the second half of our two-part series on the construction of the cherry mirror frame. And what we're going to be covering today is, first, we need to cover how we constructed the rabbets on the back sides of both the rails and the stiles, because obviously we need to be able to fit the mirror into the frame. So we're going to cover that. And what we're going to be doing with that is, number one, the rails are really simple. But when it came to the stiles, I wanted to do stopped rabbets. So it's going to stop shy at either end of the stiles. And I'll show you how I do that on the table saw using just a one blade setup. Of course, it'll be the one blade for the table saw. And then I'll show you a second blade that we'll have to use to get that out of there. But then we're going to come back. We'll have to set up the router table and we'll put a nice chamfer on the outside edges of all four pieces. Again, it's not going to be a chamfer along the entire length. What we'll end up doing is kind of doing a double stopped chamfer, if there is such a thing, but we're creating this nice little feature at either end. Some people might refer to it as a lamb's tongue, but I don't want to go that far because usually a lamb's tongue has a little bit more detail in it. But anyway, so we'll cover how we do that at the router table. Then we need to create the walnut pegs that we'll be using, the walnut dowels. I have a neat little jig that I ended up getting from Lee Valley. I'll show you a little bit about that. We won't go into too much detail. We'll save that for another day. But we'll create those, then we'll insert those, we'll drill and glue those into position. The main reason, I think I've mentioned this before, but these dowels, they're not for necessarily for decorative purposes. They do look really nice. They do help to kind of spruce it up a little bit. But I wanted to make sure that I had something that would add a little extra backup power, a little extra backup strength, a little holding power, just in case those mortise and tenons fail, especially the glue joint. Yeah, you know, I did my best last week to make sure that we get the mortise and tenon joinery nice and snug, because like we said, we want it snug but not super tight. But you just never know. I did have one that I'll admit was a little loose, but still not enough to be that overly concerned. And when you think about it, it's just a mirror frame. It's not like this thing's gonna be jostled around all over the place. So anyways, though, so we'll cover how we get that into place, and then, of course, we're going to do the whole glue up and get all that taken care of. But anyways, without further delay, let's go ahead and start right here at the table saw and talk about how we do the rabbets. Here at the table saw, we have a couple of different ways that we can create rabbets. Number one, we could either use something like the single blade method, which I'm going to demonstrate today, or two, we could do it with a dado blade. Now, the dado blade is really easy. It's very much kind of, when you think about it, setting up a rabbeting bit in your router. It's going to hog out a lot of material. It basically gets it done in one, maybe two passes at the most, and you're all set. But when I started out, I didn't have a dado blade. A dado blade, a really good dado blade, is something that can cost you a lot of money. And so I decided that I was going to learn how to do just the single blade method. And when it comes down to it, the single blade method is essentially just creating two shoulders with one blade. It's just that you have to think about the depth, and then you have to kind of set it up and think about the height. And you, voila, pop out this little extra piece of material. And on top of it, you don't create a lot of sawdust with it. So anyways, though, that's what we're going to end up doing today. Now, the rails for this are going to have rabbets all the way from one end to the other, but the stiles, the long pieces, are going to have stopped rabbets. So I went ahead and I have the blade set up for the height of the first cut that I need to make. Since the rails are the easiest, I'm going to go ahead and we'll cut those first. We'll establish that first cut. Now, once we have that taken care of, we're going to come back. We're going to leave the fence where it is, but now we need to start creating those stopped rabbets. And the first thing I did was unplug the machine, number one, but I want to establish where the back of the blade is, where the back of the blade is coming out of the tabletop here, and where the front of the blade is, where it's diving down in. I then transfer those marks right here to the fence itself. It's nice to have this surface here where I can kind of draw on, and I have these lines right here. Now, the next thing I do is I take the piece for the stiles, I figure out where the where I want it to end, and I figure out where I want it to begin, so I have my lines established for where the stopped rabbets are going to begin and end. I mark on the sides of those, so I make sure that the face and edges that I'm looking at on the piece I can see the lines. So what I'll end up doing is I'll come back in and I'm gonna match those lines, one here at the front, so at the beginning of the piece, that way I can kind of drop it down. And then as I push the piece through, I'll be able to see where I want it to stop, and again, it will match up here. Now what's gonna end up happening is when we do this, when we flip the piece over, we'll notice, of course, that the blade doesn't cut all the way at the depth to that finished line. So we'll have to come back in and do a little work, and I'll show you how to do that in a second. But anyway, so we have this first setup ready to go. Let's go ahead and make that cut, and you can see what I'm talking about with starting it and then stopping it based on the lines that I draw on the board to represent the beginning and ending, and then using these lines to tell me where the blade starts protruding through the table and where it drops back down into it. So starting with that first mark, I'll line it up with the backside mark where the blade is first starting to come up through the table. I'll then push it forward. And we're gonna continue until that last mark on the wood lines up with what would essentially be where the blade dives down. Now at this point, I can easily reach over and I can turn off my saw, which I have a nice little leg kick for that. I hold it in place until the blade comes to a dead stop. It's now stopped, we'll flip it over. And there's our blind cut. Now for this next cut, we raise the blade. And if you noticed, I put those two new marks on here. And that's because since the blade is raised, it's now gonna be coming up through the table at a different location and dropping down through the table in a different location. But the technique is still the same. Unfortunately, because the wood is so much higher, we're just gonna have to kind of line things up first before we get going. So take your time, pay attention. Probably wouldn't hurt to have an auxiliary fence, but we can make do with this. And we're just gonna push it again from first line. And then we'll continue to the ending where we'll line it up with the second line. And the result is gonna be, again, another pass for our stopped rabbet. So once we establish both shoulders for the rabbet, it's just time to come over to the workbench. I grab my dovetailing saw and we made the cut to remove the material. Now remember, with the rails, we did a full rabbet all the way from one end to the other. So we're gonna drop the rails down into the mortise and tenon joint, and we're gonna use that as a reference for where we want the waste material to be removed from the blind rabbets that we're doing here. Just to be on the safe side, I'm gonna go ahead and mark the lines on this so I know exactly where it's gonna be. If you end up going outside of these lines, it's no big deal. Remember, this is the back side of the mirror, so this is the part that's gonna kind of be hidden away against the wall or against the door, wherever it's going. But still, it's kind of nice to get this if we can. One thing I wanna do is I'm gonna end up using, again, the dovetail saw to come in and waste away as much of this material as I can to get my curves established. This will be a lot like if we were gonna cut blind dovetails, if you've ever done that before. So I'm gonna readjust the material so I can get the saw into there because it was a little too close to the moxen vise. We'll readjust the camera so we can get a better look at this. And then now we're gonna come in on a very steep angle and we're just gonna work kind of a diagonal line. I'm gonna try and drop the blade as much as I can on this backside, as you can see, without going too deep into it, because if we went too deep on the edge, we'd actually cut into the mortise. Now to help kind of establish more of the curve again for where I'm gonna drop my chisel, which is coming next, I'm just gonna use, again, the rabbet as a guide to help cut that area, and we'll just kind of go back and forth here. And we're just about ready to switch tools. Now I'm gonna play with it, see I can kind of break it off, and you can kind of see a little bit more of how we're able to get in there. Now it's just coming in with the chisel and just kind of prying things away. Be very careful at this point. Listen to the wood, feel with the tool. I know that sounds kind of funny, but you can actually get some feedback from the material. And slowly just kind of par things away here. But once again, I'm taking the saw and I'm trying to get in a little bit deeper with that kerf so I have some place to drop the chisel into, and it will help to kind of sever the fibers so that we don't get major tear out here, because this could really just completely rip away on us if we're not careful. But that's all there really is to it. At this point, it's just a matter of really kind of cleaning it up, but we are all the way in, and it's pretty much at the same exact level as the rest of the rabbet. Once we complete this last little bit of cleanup, we'll go ahead and we'll just move to the other end, and we'll repeat the entire process. Now that we have the rabbets completely cut, we have them on the rails and the stiles, and of course on the stiles, you just watched as we cleaned it out so that we have the stopped rabbets. It's time to move on to the chamfered effect that we have on the edges. And again, we're not gonna do a chamfer all the way from one end to the other. We're doing more or less what's a stopped chamfer at either end. So we're gonna head over to the router table to do this. Now, just like how we did the stopped rabbets on the table saw, we're gonna basically do the same exact thing on the router table. On the back of the router table, we have the fence in position, and we're gonna mark on the wood itself where we want it to stop and where we want it to start, or start and stop. And we're gonna kind of line up that back side there so that we have it exactly in position. Now, it would be really nice if we had a zero clearance fence here, but we don't. We just kind of have these pieces that slide back and forth. But they're gonna be great reference marks for us because that's exactly what we're gonna line up our start and stop marks with. So we get those in position, we do a little test fitting, a little test cutting on some scrap material, and we're good to go. So we line it up with that first mark, slowly and very carefully drop it down onto the bit, and then start to make our first pass. And now we're at the second mark, so we'll go ahead and stop the router. And there you can see, we have our first one. There is a little bit of burn, but that's no big deal. Now with the long pieces, we're actually gonna have two different start locations and two different stop locations based on whether it's an inside or outside. So we'll pay extra close attention when we start that. And here's the result. So I decided I also wanted to carry that chamfering onto the ends, and it really couldn't be any easier. We could do this with the router, but instead what I want to do is take it back over to the workbench, and we're going to use our block plane. So we're going to take it from this to this. And to do that, what we're going to use is we're going to start with our marking gauge. Now, the marking gauge is going to be set for the same distance on all of these layout lines that you're watching, so we'll go ahead, mark it on the two faces on the end, and then we're going to mark it on the two edges on the end here on the end grain. Once we have those established, we're then going to set it on the workbench, and we're going to do it again on the two faces, and then we'll flip it onto the two edges. And again, we don't change the distance of the marking gauge. We're going to remove the same amount of material on top and on the sides also. Then we just take the block plane and we start connecting the two lines. It's okay if you start on one part of it and just kind of say maybe start removing more material on the face without ever touching the line on the end, or vice versa, and then just slowly dropping it into position. It takes a little practice, but this kind of freehand chamfering gives you some really nice results without having to turn on a machine, without having major blowout, and you get some nice feedback. As you can see, we're pretty much right to that line, just a little bit more to take care of. But first, let's go ahead and start defining all the other edges that we're going to do. So we'll go ahead and do the end here. And once we get this all taken care of, these first couple of passes, we'll come back and do any touch up if we need to. As you can see at this point, like I mentioned, I went to the outside line, so now I'm gonna go ahead and start chamfering it so I can get to that second line, that inside line on the end grain. And by doing this, like I mentioned, we're kind of connecting the lines. It's almost like connecting the dots. By connecting those two lines, this will give us a really nice, crisp, uniform chamfer all the way around. Now it's time for the glue up. We've done a few dry runs to make sure that the mortises match up properly with the tenons and that everything's ready to go and not too snug, but not too loose. We're just gonna drop the glue down into the mortises themselves. In fact, that's where the majority of the glue is gonna go. And we don't need an excessive amount of glue. We don't want a lot of squeeze out here. So we're just gonna put enough into the bottom, and then we'll come back with a nice stick here and spread everything around and what we want to do is kind of get like a nice painted on coat on the inside. That's going to guarantee that when we insert the tenon, that the glue isn't going to go all over the place, but instead stay right where we want it. As you can kind of see, it's everywhere, but not too much. Then it's a matter of just dropping the proper tenons in, and I made sure to mark everything so that I know exactly where it's going to go. Put everything into position. And the nice thing is, this is only a couple of glue joints, so it's a matter of just taking a couple of clamps, snugging everything into place, and we're pretty much done here. So not so long ago, I kind of pointed to a tool in the background and said, we're going to be talking about that pretty soon. This is that tool, and in fact, you're going to see what it does in just a second here. This is a Veritas dowel and tenon maker, and the idea is very simple. It has kind of a wide diameter opening here. You feed stock through, preferably more of a squarish stock. It has this cutter. It then takes it down to the dimension here on the backside. Like I said, this is a 7/16 inch version. They have a couple other sizes. And more or less, the neat thing about this is that you can take scrap material that you have, maybe some exotic, and you can turn it into dowels for whatever project you're using. I don't know about you, but whenever I've walked around the home centers, I've never seen anything like, you know, a walnut dowel. I've never seen like purple heart dowel. I've never seen anything like that at all. It's just usually basically poplar or even like maple or something. So you can make your own, and in fact, the nice thing with this too is you can also make it specifically for like maybe the end grain that you want, so it's a certain direction or a certain pattern or something. Really neat. As you can see in the video, like I mentioned, you just simply feed it in one end, it spins around, and it comes out the other end. You can spin it by two different ways. I tried doing it simply by hand. It works, just takes a little while to do it. The other way is more or less just to take a regular old socket. In fact, I ended up buying this one from Lee Valley just to make it easier because I wasn't sure I'd have it. But this one's a half inch dowel or socket. I then take my material, I cut it so it's a half inch, fit it right into position. I then put this into my drill driver and spin away it goes, and I make the material for the next step, which is going to be creating those pegs which go into the mortise and tenon to help reinforce it. It's time to lay out where we're going to put the dowels. We're going to use this little story stick to help us do it. I have two marks. The first one is going to be the depth in from the end on the style. And then we're going to flip it and use the second one to mark in from the edge of the style so that this is going to be approximately about a half inch in from the edge. And we have a 1-inch tenon, so this should give us a really nice location for it. The next thing we're going to do is come in with our Forstner bit, and we're going to get this all lined up. The depth we want to go to is, it actually works out to about where that mark is. So we'll go ahead and start drilling, taking our time to be very careful not to mess up the face here, and we'll just keep drilling. One thing with this depth, we're not going all the way through. It's actually about 3/4 of the way through. It's enough to go through the first face, then through the tenon, and into the remaining materials, which will really help to strengthen it up with that dowel. Now that that's taken care of, we want to then drop in some glue, and just like with our mortise, we don't want too much, we just want enough to kind of help hold it in position. So we'll paint the walls a little bit with our stick here. The next step is to apply a little extra glue to the sides of the dowel. Again, kind of make sure it's not going to go anywhere. And then now we're just going to pound the whole thing into place. And by pound, I mean actually pound this into position. It's snug, but yet it's not going to split the wood. And now that that's there, we're going to go ahead and flush cut this. And by flush cut in this situation, I don't mean flush cut it right to the face of the material. I'm going to be a little proud. And this has two purposes. One, originally I was planning on maybe doing a little chamfering on the plugs themselves, but also I want to be able to come in and more cautiously smooth them down so that I don't have a lot of tool marks. But it doesn't take much with a nice sharp flush cutting saw. And that's pretty much the end of the construction of the entire frame itself. What we ended up doing was coming back in, and like I mentioned, originally I had planned on kind of chamfering those edges of the dowels themselves, kind of giving it like almost like a pyramid type look. But instead I decided to flush them all the way down so that they're even with the entire surface of the face frame. And to be honest with you, I kind of like the look of that, the way it ended up turning out. I applied just some armor seal on it. I wanted nothing major on it. We weren't gonna like make it really glossy or anything, just enough to protect it. And we have the following result. And to be quite honest with you, we're really, really happy with this. And by we, I mean my wife is really happy with this. And in fact, as soon as I finish up this video, the next thing I need to do is get upstairs and actually install it. So I really should kind of take off from here and get started with that job. I hope you enjoyed this, and hopefully we've covered everything on how to get this taken care of. If you have any questions at all about the build process, anything we did versus not doing it another way, let me know those questions, and maybe we'll come back in and we'll do a third episode where we'll cover all of those questions and suggestions maybe you have for it. And of course, you can send those to mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com, or you can head over to the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com where you can leave it there too in today's show notes. So I want to thank all of you for stopping by, and I'll be talking to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.